Please welcome on stage Corps member Sebastian Kurfürst. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm extremely thrilled to be here. So, let's get started with this last talk of this year's NEOS conference. I'm going to talk about NEOS, but actually not in the sense of the whole thing, but I'm going to talk about the NEOS packages. So you all know the NEOS package and the Flow Framework package, which is the framework underneath the system. But actually, that are only the most two prominent ones. We have a few more modules which are relevant for us. And the first one is the content repository, which stores all our data in the node structure. You have probably heard about that. We have the media package for asset storage, for binaries, and so on. We have Fusion for rendering. And that's also, for instance, the NEOS user interface, which provides the React-based user interface. Sorry that my voice is a little raspy. I hope it's OK. So this talk is about one of these components, which is the content repository. And I'm going to demonstrate the current version of the content repository with a really, really simple example. I only want to move a single node in my system. So if we log into our NEOS instance, that's just a normal NEOS instance, NEOS 4.3. And what I'm going to do now, I'll take this features node here, and I'll drag it into underneath this try me node. And you see, I'll wait. It still says saving, I'll wait. And now it's published. And actually, well, 154 things have changed. What the hell? I just did one single change, actually. So why are there actually so many changes? Who knows that, by the way, why there are so many? Who likes it? OK, so I'm going to explain what happens behind the scenes so that you get a feeling about what happens. To understand that, you actually need to look into the database. We have a single main database table, which is called the node data table. And it consists of the so-called materialized path for every node in the system. And as you can imagine, when you move a node underneath another node, all these paths change. So we need to touch the path of the node itself, but also the paths of all subnodes. And you also see that, so that's in the live workspace, a certain node. And in my user workspace, we see the features node is actually underneath the try me node. And the problem is that's not even enough, because when we move, we have this shine-through behavior, right? So we only display changes from my user workspace when you didn't, when you change them, actually. Everything else you see from the live workspace. But as we move the node away, actually, we see the old node still shining through. So we need to do some really ugly hacks. We have some special column moved to, and we have to handle that in all cases to actually hide the node at the original location. Don't worry if you don't understand any of that. I actually don't either. So the only thing to keep in mind is move node is actually a really, really complex case with lots of edge case. And we didn't even talk about dimensions or anything like that yet. And this is actually, this example shows why this content repository is a little hard to evolve with new features. We want to do a lot of new cool features, but actually we cannot do that because of this current architecture. So let's have a look at the current architecture of the content repository. To the outside, it looks quite OK. We have Fusion Flow Query and the node interface, which deals with reading and writing. We have a node type management. There's the node data and node data repository. And that's not public API anymore. That is why it's shaded. And there, things get a little more difficult. We have stuff like this shadow node stuff. We have dimension handling floating around. We have this workspace shine through floating around. Then we have an object relational mapper doctrine with an identity map. And we have some pretty naive database schema. And actually, the problem is that, like in this node data blob, that's not well defined at all. It's just some big chunk of code, which is very hard to understand, even for us who have been working with it. If you change something, actually, the chances that you break other things are really, really high. And the ORM is really slow for big node trees, and the performance is especially hard to predict because a lot of things are going on behind the scenes which we don't even see. And actually, who has ever encountered an orphan node, so a node which was visible before but which didn't is not there anymore, basically? Yeah, exactly. And that happens because the parent node somehow disappeared, and so we cannot find this node anymore. And it also triggers some quite hard to reproduce bugs. So let's show step by step what is actually changing with the new content repository. First thing, on the we'll split the read and the write side apart, and actually there are not so many things change. It's some renaming going on, so the node interface becomes the traversable node interface, and we have commands on the write side. The next step is more important. We replace all the scrap of node data with two really clean layers about handling dimension space and content streams. Content streams is an internal name for some workspace parts, so actually that's like the layer handling all the workspaces. Then we will replace the ORM with Doctrine DBAL, so the database abstraction layer, so that we can directly do database queries and we can get rid of all this ORM magic. And finally, we're going to replace the naive database schema with both an event store and a content graph. And all of them are actually now in blue, except in dark blue, except the DBAL, because that's all public API. That's all things you can rely on that which provide well-defined interfaces and APIs. So, meaning this dimension space and content stream layer has now a well-defined and sound concept. The content graph is optimized for moving and other really complex cases. And we strive for a good basis for advanced features and a really good performance. Don't worry if you didn't get around all these blocks and so on. The only thing to remember is it's a really, really big change behind the scenes. And the question is, why actually do we want that? And there's one analogy to it. It's basically what we want to create. We want to create Git for content. So who works with Git? Who likes it? Quite some people, actually. Same for me. You know, it's really predictable. You have the feeling there are some things you need to know, but actually it's really clean and really clear to use in most cases. So actually that's what we want to build. So to understand what we want to achieve, we have to have a look at the basics, which are event sourcing and CQRS, just in a quick nutshell. In a classical database architecture, you have your model and your database, and you modify it and you read it. And that's just the normal models you always do. And as soon as you modify the model, the old state is gone. With the event-sourced architecture, it's basically looking the same, except that the core of your system is not your model anymore, but the events and the event store. So how does such an event list actually look like? Actually, it's just a list of things which happen to your system. So stuff like updating node properties, creating nodes, creating workspace, these are all events, and the event store just stores them one by one in a big, single, long list, basically. And modification becomes appending events, and reading becomes updating projections. So what actually is a projection? So let's have a look. When something like updating a projection happens, we have to consume an event, and then we update some kind of model. So that's actually where our model switch to. And this is the model we can normally read. So basically, the model is, for our case, it's just database tables, just pretty much like the old structure, but in a different shape. And by doing that, by shifting the source of truth from this database model to the event store, something really important happens, which is that projections can be rebuilt. So just imagine there is some kind of corruption in these database tables here. What we can do, we can empty them all. And then obviously they are empty, and then we can start applying event one. Then, you know, we started with filling it. We apply event two, three, four, until event 1000 or wherever we are. And this way we can very reliably also fix bugs on the projection side. So, to give you an understanding about the overall flow of what happens when a user does change something, let's have a look. So let's follow a user action, like the user creates a node in the user interface. What happens in the system is that a command is dispatched. So something like, please create this workspace for me. Then this is transformed into events, which say something like, well, this workspace has been created, and this is stored in the event store. And don't worry about all the names. The event store is basically just a really, really long list of things. And by doing that, we then start filling the projection side of things. So we start filling this content graph. And you see on the left, you see the read side with the projections. And on the right side, you see the write side. And at this point, you might actually wonder, what is actually the benefit from that? The only thing which changes is we store all the events in the meantime. The thing is, we can now start to denormalize our data. So we can start to create specialized projections for certain use cases. For instance, the content graph is really, really good in answering many questions about the general structure of the tree, but it's very bad at discovering what actually has changed. So in a workspace. So we can create a new projection which stores these workspace changes and it tells us what has changed in this workspace. And you can actually extend that. You can create new projections if you like. But needless to say, the main projection actually is the content graph which is applied. Right. So this architecture has loads of consequences. Just three of them. We know what has happened in the past. We know every single state change which happened in the system since the very beginning. And that is the source of truth. And that is an extremely powerful concept. Second, we have to build a sound and consistent concept. So that means event sourcing actually forces us to think through all the special cases in advance. And we couldn't have done that a few years ago because we didn't know the advanced cases, but now we actually do know the advanced cases and we can think about like what has to happen in which combination in advance. So that's also, in my opinion, quite a benefit for us at least. And third, let's talk about some consistency things which change. So a software system can be either consistent immediately or strongly consistent. Or it can be not consistent. Of course, you know, you don't want to have a not consistent system. Everybody wants to have this shiny, immediately consistent system, but it's extremely hard to achieve, and it turns out that an immediately consistent system is very, very slow at high loads. And between immediately and not consistent, there's a really, really big gap, and this is so-called eventually consistent. Just one remark for everybody in German, eventually is not eventuell. Eventually means at some point in the future, so you could translate it with bald. So that means the system might have short periods of time where it is not consistent, but in the end it has to converge to a consistent state again after some seconds, for instance. And it turns out that in this eventually consistent, by designing a system eventually consistent, we can do lots of optimizations for very high performance and very high numbers of users, for instance. So I'll give you an example about that in a bit. So how far are we actually? When we started 2.5 years ago, we had no clue what we were actually doing. So there was the first workshop in December 2016, where we met and where we discussed our ideas with Matthias Veres. And these were obviously very, very rough ideas. And then we had to think that through and let that digest. And then we had another workshop in Kiel in September 2017. Whoop, that's quick somehow. And we met in March 2018 as well. And you might remember at last year's NEOS conference, we've also had a talk about event sourcing, right? So, and the event sourced content repository. And it was actually possible to edit something, which was a great step for us. But I have to tell you one really dirty secret. Actually, last year at the conference, we basically forked Neos. You know, we just took all the source code, we patched it at the places where we needed it to be. It only worked on the demo side, only on the cases where we actually, you know, which we tried out beforehand. It was only possible to change a property, but not possible to create a new one, not possible to move something, and so on and so on. It was really, really, really limited. So it was still in a feasibility and performance study stage. And then we took the first round of funding in October 2018. From the Neos team. And what's the status right now? I'm going to show now. So let's start with an existing Neos 4.3 site. What you actually do, you install some packages. I'll explain it in a bit. And after that, you run a command saying content repository migrate run, and it takes all your nodes and converts into the new structure. And then you have to run two other commands. That's not optimized for or polished in any way yet. That's just really the small thing. As soon as that is done, you can actually start your Flow server. And you can go to the back end, or actually first go to the front end. You can click around, and actually you don't see a big change. It's, your content is there. You can travel around on your website. It looks pretty normal, doesn't it? We can look into the login to the back end. No big deal. Did we actually change something? Are we at the right instance? I'm not so sure anymore. So it actually looks pretty much the same. Yeah, so let's move a node. Ah, only one change, not 150-something. That's actually the first thing which we saw as a difference. So in the legacy system, we had lots of changes. In the event source, we have one. And that means in the legacy system, we would have a lot of potential merge conflicts. In the event source system, we would not. So let's look at the database table, what is actually stored in the event log. Because there, we actually see the difference. We go to this events table, we take the last event, and there we see actually this nodes removed event. And we can open it up. And here we actually see that a node was moved from one to another location. So we know this history and we have this information tracked. And there's, for instance, also this change table, which stores this number up there. And don't worry, why there are three lines in with different content stream identifiers. That's a really implementation detail. The thing is it basically tells us that one single node has changed. It's in this node aggregate identifier column, the fourth column. So let's try to exercise this immediate consistency. I now have two browsers and two different users. And what I'm now trying, I'm going to concurrently edit content on the same page. So first, left one is admin, right one is Sebastian. So we log in. It's a little narrow, a little cramped on the right side. Let's give some space. So the right user actually, well, more space, come on. I was slow when I recorded that. Okay, so now we start changing things. On the left side, we change something else. Okay. And the left user is really quick, he publishes already. So what would we expect? We would expect that this nice content changes already on the live side. And we would expect that also the user on the right side, he would see this create nice content headline because actually it shines through, right? That's what we discussed about. So let's try it out. Wow, something is wrong. Clickers are not a good thing somehow currently, but it still seems to work. Oops. Sorry. What is wrong with these clickers? Ah, no, something is. Sorry, I have to. So, okay, we published it. We'll try once more this video. Sorry. Okay, so now what we see on the live website, actually, it says create nice content, and we reloaded our right side, and it still says create content, so it doesn't match. So actually, this change has applied on the live website, but it did not apply in your user workspace, and that's actually strange. And if we log in and out again, then something is really wrong with this clicker. Sorry. If we log in and out again, then we see this change. Thank you. Oh no. Let's have it running. Let's log out. I just switch off the clicker. And after we've logged in again, then we see that this nice content is actually seeable. And yeah, next one, please. Next one. So what actually has happened here? We've seen a case of eventual consistency. The system was not consistent for a certain short amount of time, and then something changed. We logged in again, and then we saw the changes. And this will happen in the background automatically, and it will allow us to optimize a huge variety of cases. Okay, sorry for the broken demo. So what did we actually work on recently? It's not a fork anymore. It's installable in a standard 4.3 user base. But we still need a minor patch to the UI. We've found and implemented a migration strategy, which is that we have on the legacy system the node interface. In the new one, we have some more classes, traversable node interface and commands. Now it works again. Okay, just stay there as a background. It's a good karma, certainly. The traversable node interface is included in Neos 4.3, so that means you can start migrating to that already. And the node data repository is replaced by the content graph and subgraph. And there is also a planned node mutation for updates. So the API is essentially segmented and we move things around, but it's basically still there. We have a standalone set of packages. And so currently we have an event source content repository and event source Neos adjustments, which you can install alongside your site. But this will eventually be merged into the content repository and Neos packages. We will also experiment in the future with graph databases. So that was why it's very important for me that we had, for instance, a talk about Neo4j today. So for very high performance and big sites, that's a very interesting opportunity to pursue. We implemented many of the difficult features, stuff like moving nodes, deleting nodes, showing and hiding nodes. We've implemented shine-through workspaces, content dimensions, and partial publishing. And so we actually solved many of these hard problems. And then there's one thing I'm particularly excited about. We actually prepared the CR for standalone usage. So that means in a year from now, you will very likely be able to install the content repository in a plain Symfony application, in a plain PHP application, and you can benefit from all of this functionality without any Neos or Flow usage at all. And we hope to be able to greatly expand the community for that by that, and also to market Neos this way to other developers. What about performance? Right now, we have comparable front-end performance. It's still a point for optimization, but at this point, we are already roughly at the level we had before. I think that's quite fine for now. So I wouldn't call that an experiment anymore. The risk is mostly gone. 1 year ago, we couldn't even name the risk. We couldn't tell you what the risks were. And now we are having a really quick and clear view and a clear roadmap. So actually, this is now the release of the Neos Content Repository Alpha 1. It is still rough around the edges, but you can start to play around with it. But please don't use it in production just yet. There will be some renamings, some cleanups in the upcoming days and weeks. And as soon as that settles down, then we'll start to use it in smaller production sites first. So how do we actually migrate? Well, today actually we won't support dimensions first. support means we won't give support to you as a community yet. However, internally we already have dimensions with fallbacks implemented, but we first want to fix the easy bugs, so to speak, so the bugs which happen without any content dimensions. We are starting to test with about 50,000 nodes in the system, but we currently only support 10,000 officially, so for like what you can trust on for now and the first start. A little in the future, we'll start to enable dimensions without fallbacks and we'll support 50,000 nodes. And then we'll again test with even higher node numbers and also support dimension with fallbacks. So, how can you actually get this thing? You all know Composer, so what you currently still need to do is you have to put in two Composer repositories into the system, and then you can just you have to add a few lines to the require statement. Then you run Composer update, and this way you get your Composer these packages installed, and they will directly modify. They will hook into various places and override various places in Neo. So please don't do that in production, because as soon as you add that, it's really, you know, changing behavior of Neos. And then you can actually start migrating content by these four commands. You still have to compile the Neos user interface. We are getting rid of that really soon. It's really a small patch. Yeah, and then actually you are ready to try it and to give us feedback. So, if you want to give us feedback, please come to Slack. Project CR Rewrite is the place to be there. Or on GitHub, there's a content repository development collection where all the stuff what we are doing resides. And there's also project boards where you see what are we doing, what's actually next priorities, what have we done in the future. And needless to say, there's quite some work left. So I would say we are currently at a point like 2 years ago of the state of the React UI 2 years ago. If you remember back then, we had a working prototype. We showed it on the conference. It was quality-wise, it was still worse than the current version of the UI. So it was like at an 80% shape, so to speak. And I would say the CR is at a comparable position. It's like 70% done or something like that. And of course, the last 30% will be quite a lot of work still. And it's quite a lot of work to have that really polished and well done so that you don't have pains upgrading. So I personally would currently estimate that we would need about 50 to 100,000 euros if we would all try to pay it, or if this would be all paid money. I'm totally aware this is a lot of money, actually this is it's not a big deal if we don't get that much money, you know. But then we won't be able to say it will be ready by then. But if we would have this amount of money, I would expect that in a year from now we would have a beta version which is actually installed in quite some installations, which we would use as a team internally in quite some projects already, and which some more users who would like to try that could actually run that in production. So just to give you a rough idea, we have a really clear plan what we need to do by now, and so now it's actually about the doing. So let's talk about some dreams. Why are we actually doing that? What could we imagine by that? There's Jens Hoffmann, who has been part of the Neos user experience long time ago, when it was still Typo3 Phoenix in 2009 and 2010. And actually, Jens sent me these nice screens, which he created back then. And when I first saw that, like 10 years ago, actually, by the way, hi, Jens. I'm not sure where you are. it's really cool to have you, by the way. So, he created something like a change protocol, and you had this slider up there and you could move it, and then you saw on the page what has changed. And I was like totally stunned when I saw that, and I was like, oh, I want to have that, but I have no clue how to build that in any sense. And with the event sourced content repository, I think this actually is a huge step into making that possibility a reality. So we would be able to have all this information, and we could build something like that after we have the basis done. And I think that is an extremely powerful concept which can put Neos quite in front of many other systems. What I would personally like to build is something like editing notifications. So that means Neos should guide you more in your workflow. If you change something in German, for instance, Neos could tell you, please don't forget to update the English version of your website, you know, because if your company name changed in German, then you also have to change it in English version, for instance. So, and there should be a place where Neos tells you, oh, didn't you forget to change it there? Because it was only changed in one language. We could, for instance, synchronize content across various different instances of Neos. So you could replicate your content partially or fully across the globe if you want to. And the most important thing is that we believe we don't actually know the ideas you will come up with yet at this point. So that means we will have a really good solution, a stable basis where we can actually build lots and lots of advanced features on. And that's actually what I would hope to happen when this all becomes a reality. So what should you actually remember when you leave for this talk? There's one thing, there's actually two things. The first thing, it's like Git for content. If there's one thing to remember, then this is what we try to achieve. And second, well, it's actually the third rewrite, and it turns out we usually try to rewrite things three times, and the third one is actually usually a good one. So I hope this is also the case here. And with that, I would actually like to say thank you. Thank you so much, and thanks all for having us here, and really good that you were here. Thank you so much.